This panel is essential because palliative care is a fledgling discipline in the bloom of youth. As recently as 2006, the American Board of Medical Specialties and the Accreditation Council for Graduate Medical Education recognized the subspecialty of hospice and palliative medicine. 2006. Officially less than a dozen years old, palliative medicine demands historical perspective. So we begin tonight as far back as 400 BCE, 2,500 years ago, with a tragedy written by the renowned Greek playwright Sophocles. Tonight's panel, as Priscilla intimated, is brand new and part of a larger research initiative. Thanks to a grant from the International Catacomb Society, the support of Perkins School of Theology, and also Mauro Ferrari, the CEO of the Houston Methodist Research Institute, we've begun to bring together an outstanding group of scholars and palliative care experts who have committed in all their free time to read ancient texts on pain with two simple questions in mind. Bear these two questions in mind as the evening progresses, though these simple questions belie the enormous complexity behind them. The one question is this: what light, if any, can our knowledge of pain shed on the experience of pain in ancient texts, in antiquity? What we know, what does it tell us about what they experienced? Flip that around and ask the second question: what light, if any, can antiquity shed on our experience of pain? Is there anything we can learn from these ancient texts? Well, in order to ask and answer this question, we've got a really wonderful group of people who hail from Boston, like Angela, from Columbus, Ohio, from Dallas, from Houston, from Long Island, from New York City, and from Princeton, New Jersey. All of these together have committed to answer these two questions and also to see what new questions will develop out of what we are doing. But to focus right now on tonight's panel, let me give you a little introduction to each. And I've given you a handout. I always have handouts. This red and blue one, the SMU color one. The four panelists are there. We have, first of all, Bob Fine, who's the Clinical Director of Clinical Ethics and Palliative Care at Baylor Scott & White, Texas. And Bob and I have actually gotten to know each other a little bit only through this project. We have Angela Kim Harkins, who's Associate Professor of New Testament at Boston College School of Theology and Ministry, and a tremendous scholar of the world called Second Temple Judaism, which includes the Dead Sea Scrolls and things like that. And in fact, Angela tomorrow will be teaching a full day on the Dead Sea Scrolls, an introduction to the Dead Sea Scrolls. The third person who's on our panel, whom you do not see, is Brooke Holmes, because she's in the monitor. Can Brooke see us?
I can see you.
Hi, Brooke. I'm just meeting Brooke for the first time through that little aperture there on that camera. Brooke is the Robert F. Goheen Professor in the Humanities and Professor of Classics and Director of the Interdisciplinary PhD Program in Humanistic Studies at Princeton University. And she doesn't join us in person because she has a wee daughter way up there where she lives in New York City. And apparently she is actually at a colleague's home, so that there won't be any baby sounds in the background. Right? Is that right, Brooke?
Yes.
Yes, she's elsewhere. So let me give you a little introduction to the evening so we know where we're going. After we consulted with each other, we decided to begin what we hope will be a long and productive journey with three fascinating ancient texts. The first is Sophocles, I'm going to say this wrong, Philoctetes, right, Brooke?
Good.
Yeah?
Very good.
Okay.
Philoctetes.
In which Philoctetes, a hero of the Trojan Wars, but now an exile on the island of Lemnos, experiences excruciating pain in his foot from a snake bite, for which there is only one remedy, one that is highly unpalatable to him, though ultimately unavoidable. Maybe Brooke will tell you what that is. The second text we're going to be dealing with tonight is called the Testament of Job, an ancient Jewish or Christian revision of the biblical book of this tragic figure, Job, who scraped his sores on an ash heap, sick, bereft of his family, his children, and without any possessions left. However, the text that Angela will deal with is the Testament of Job, not the biblical Job. And the ancient later text is very different. It's an embellishment of the original biblical story of Job, in which the hues of pain and disease are even more vivid than in the original biblical account. You might say, with all the medical knowledge I have, you basically have Job on steroids in the Testament of Job.
Except he'd feel better if he did it.
He would feel better with steroids, Bob says. Yeah. Oh, I wish I had steroids. The third text we'll be dealing with tonight, and I'll be introducing this one, is called The Greek Life of Adam and Eve, which is another ancient Jewish or Christian retelling of a biblical story. Again, like the Testament of Job, this is not the biblical Adam and Eve, but a later ancient story written prior to the 4th century, we're sure of. This tale is a fascinating reinvention of the story of Adam and Eve, Cain and Abel, and Seth. And in this ancient story, disease and pain with it play a fundamental role in defining human life. We'll see tonight a great deal in these ancient texts. We'll see sheer pain. We'll see various forms of exile due to pain. We'll see various degrees of empathy for those who have pain. And we'll encounter questions of causality and divine justice. Antiquity is not obsolete. Its durability offers us the opportunity to explore, in ways we may not have imagined, the experience of pain and suffering, healing and wholeness that touches us all. In fact, at 6:20 tonight, I received an email from a person who was coming with his spouse to this. Wrote me a month ago and said, I'm coming to this. And at 6:20, I received this email that said, I can't come tonight. My wife's aunt was one of the people on the bus near San Antonio, and she was killed. So pain, grief, touch us all, even tonight. Now, let me give you a little bit on logistics, and then I'm going to let us take off, okay? If you look at your handout, this is not done in a particularly normal way. Basically, we've divided the evening up in 25-minute segments. We're going to look at Sophocles, we're going to look at the Testament of Job, and we're going to look at the Greek life of Adam and Eve. We're going to do them for 25 minutes each. Essentially, Brooke, Angela, and I will introduce these texts so you know what we're talking about. Then Bob Fine will reflect on each in turn as a palliative care expert. Then we're going to open it up to you. Now, here's how this is going to work. With 25 minutes each and 3 parts, we each get 8 minutes. Okay? So 8 minutes for an introduction, 8 minutes for Bob's response, and 8 minutes for you to talk and ask questions and make comments. So, because time is of the essence, certainly in life, definitely tonight, you might even want to write your questions down on the back of your handout, and then you're going to have to wait for a microphone to come to you because we're being recorded. And, I mean, we don't know who will watch this, but we have people all around. No, we do. I have people in Houston who said, we obviously can't come to this, but she's at Houston Hospital and she trains the chaplain. She said, but I really want to be able to be there. Can you possibly record it? So we have. Note as well that on each table there's a lot of great information about continuing events at Perkins, but there's also a pink sheet. Do you see the pink sheet at your table? Yeah, a pink sheet. This is a sign-up sheet that if you want to be kept in the loop about this research, we will do that. But again, we don't have a precedent and we don't have an outcome, so we don't know exactly what we're going to keep you abreast of, but we assume that something's going to happen. And if the emails that have been exchanged this week between between Brooke, Angela, Bob, and myself are any indication, a lot is going to happen. Let me conclude my introduction of this by saying I led a faculty colloquium on Monday about pain and about this project and what was going on here at Perkins School of Theology. Afterwards, one of my faculty colleagues, Theo Walker, came up to me and talked for a while, and with robust optimism about this venture, really more of an adventure than a venture, he summed up our future well. Theo said this, we have, quote, a group of top-notch people thinking about a profoundly important subject, unquote. Something good is bound to happen. So Sophocles, Brooke, we're ready for you.
Great. Can everyone hear me okay?
Yes.
Yeah, great. Well, it's really a pleasure to be here virtually, and I want to thank Jack for not just putting together this panel, but coming up with this really innovative project. I'm a classicist, I'm trained as a classicist, but I have strong interests in the philosophical questions around palliative care and contemporary biomedical ethics, and so it's a really wonderful opportunity to enter into a productive conversation. I also take really seriously the question mark at the end of the title for this event, and so what I really want to do in my 7.5 minutes now is to put some questions on the table and have a chance to discuss them. So what I'm going to do is just say a couple words about why I chose the text, a Greek tragedy text, not a text from ancient medicine or other sources, and what I think tragedy in particular can do to help us think through some of these questions. I'll talk a little bit about the play and the myth of Philoctetes to fill you in on the drama. And then I'm going to put two questions, bigger questions, on the table for us to think about. And Jack hit on them in one word in his presentation, exile and empathy. And those will really be the kinds of poles that my discussion will orbit. So Greek tragedy is a genre of performance that originates in the late 6th century in Athens, so about 2,500 years ago, and flourishes for about 100 years. We don't know the origins, probably in the cult of Dionysus, but we do know by the time of the early 5th century, it's become integral to civic life in Athens. And so I say that because this is not just a literary genre that people were reading in their homes or going to the theater the way we do today, but it was really a central part of the city and the life of the city. One of the reasons tragedy is so important is because of what we might call a principle that's articulated in one of our earlier tragedies, Aeschylus's Agamemnon, that's called the pathemathos, which translates into learning through suffering. Learning through suffering. Greek tragedy is, if it's about anything, about suffering. It's about the suffering of great men and women on stage in very detailed and extravagant ways. Depending on how accurate you think Aristotle's assessment of tragedy is about 100 years later, it may also be about the learning through suffering that comes through our own witnessing of suffering on stage. So the learning through suffering in Agamemnon is clearly about the experience of tragic characters, but there's a broader sense of what that might mean. And I think just that maxim is something for us to think about. What does it mean to learn through suffering? What kinds of lessons are imparted? We may tend to think of tragedy to oppose that kind of learning through suffering to what we think of as knowledge today, scientific knowledge, or in the realm of suffering, biomedical knowledge, or the knowledge of physicians, and to oppose what tragedy offers to a modern way of thinking about things. And that would be to misunderstand the context in which tragedy is flourishing. So tragedy is thriving at a moment when Greek culture and a number of thinkers are really asking difficult questions about what it means to know. What does it mean to know the nature of the cosmos? What does it mean to know the nature of a human being? The word here is physis. So they're asking questions about physical reality. Another big set of questions that are relevant to tragedy are being asked by the emergent discourse of what I would call naturalizing medicine. So medicine that we associate with the name is Hippocrates. I prefer to call it Hippocratic medicine since we're not sure if Hippocrates authored any of the texts that we have, but we have about 60 extant texts. And these texts are unified, they're very different in many ways, but unified by the fact that they're all asking how suffering can be explained by looking at the physis, the nature of the body. And so it's, in essence, what they're doing, I would argue, is they're reinterpreting symptoms by giving different narratives for whatever hidden story is happening to produce pain. So if that story was told primarily to looking to the gods in earlier culture, now you have people looking at the body as a place where disease is happening. You also have the emergent discourse of law, which is starting to ask questions about human responsibility, cause and effect, and to try to come up with different kinds of narratives for harm. And so tragedy is taking place in a moment alongside all of these discourses which are asking about knowledge in a sense that feels very modern. And tragedy is in essence reacting to these discourses by both appropriating them. So the Philoctetes has quite precise medical terminology in many ways, and at the same time resisting them. And I think what tragedy is responding to is the somewhat narrow models of human suffering that medicine and law are putting forward. Tragedy sort of working out where those discourses, for all their precision and for all their perceived efficacy, exhaust themselves in giving an account of human suffering that is full and rich enough to map onto human experience. So let me say a few words about the Philoctetes. I'll try to be brief so I have time to talk about the play. Sophocles, born around 496 and dies in 406. So his life spans the 5th century. The Philoctetes is a late play. It was probably performed in 409 BCE, so towards the end of Sophocles' career. And Sophocles' Philoctetes is the last of the fourth of four plays about Philoctetes that we know of. We know Aeschylus did one, we know that Euripides did one, and Sophocles wrote another play about Philoctetes. And we don't have those plays. Sophocles is the only extant one. We have other authors from antiquity talking about them. So we know that one of the things that Sophocles does, which is really important for understanding his portrayal of Philoctetes, is the island where Philoctetes has been abandoned is deserted. There are no humans there. In the other plays that we have in Euripides, for example, there's a chorus made up of citizens of Lemnos. There are other people on the island. In Sophocles, the abandonment is total. The other thing that's important to recognize is that Neoptolemus, the son of Achilles, is going to play an important role in Sophocles' version. In other versions, you have Diomedes come to get Philoctetes. You have this young, a boy, essentially, a teenager, whose emotional and sort of social development and education is happening in the play. So Philoctetes isn't a big figure in the epic that we have, but we do know a little bit about the myth and different variants. I'll give it to you just in a bare bones. He is comes from Thessaly in northern Greece. He is a suitor for Helen, so he's going to be part of the Trojan expedition. En route to Troy, he is wounded by a snake on some island on the way to Troy. There are different versions. And because of this horrible wound that won't heal, and the horrible sounds that he makes, he is abandoned by the Greek army and exiled to this island of Lemnos. And he's been there for 10 years at the beginning of the play. The other thing is that he has a bow which cannot miss its target, the bow of Heracles. And he's been given the bow of Heracles because he was the only one who was willing to light a pyre for Heracles to commit suicide on when Heracles was dying, consumed by a flesh-eating poison. And Philoctetes played a kind of physician role, a physician-assisted death in allowing him to die. And he's given the bow of Heracles in gratitude. And so he's been abandoned for 10 years on Lemnos, and there's been a prophecy back at Troy that the Greeks need Philoctetes, or they need him and his bow in order to take Troy. And so an expedition has been sent to basically deceive him to come back to Troy because he hates the Greeks. And Neoptolemus is the instrument of the plan, this young boy who's going to persuade Philoctetes to come. So a couple of things that I just want to put on the table, because I know my time is quickly moving. One is the question of Philoctetes is very much a portrait in chronic pain and what chronic pain does to the nature of someone. And There are some arguments. Edmund Wilson has a famous essay on Philoctetes and the wound and the bow about the ennobling nature of the suffering that Philoctetes undergoes. But the clay is a little bit more ambiguous. There's a lot of emphasis on Philoctetes as a survivor. And as a survivor in a world that's animalistic. The first introduction to Philoctetes is Odysseus and Neoptolemus are examining his cave, and he's not there. And they're describing this very bare bones existence of just a mat to sleep on and some herbs that he uses for his wound. When Philoctetes, his first appearance on stage, you don't see him. You hear his cries of anguish as he comes back limping. And the chorus describes him in a kind of, he's an anti-pastoral poet, in essence. He's sort of howling. And the moment he comes on stage, he speaks Greek, which is a shock. This is a civilized man, but the attack of pain that he suffers midway through the play is an exercise in a kind of reversion to non-linguistic suffering that sort of horrifies the chorus. So he's presented in many ways as someone who's living, but not living well. And I think one of the things that the play is sort of asking us to think about are those questions. What does it mean just to stay alive, and what does it mean to live well, to live in a society, something that this is, that Philoctetes has been deprived of? What does it make you into? And in that respect, it's not always a sympathetic portrayal of Philoctetes. However, this is the second point that I want to make. There's also the perspective of Neoptolemus. And Neoptolemus responds to Philoctetes not with horror, not with just pity, but in fact a kind of sympathetic reaction when he sees this horrible attack of pain that Philoctetes undergoes halfway through the play. He is stunned, and he says, I am stunned to silence by being pained at your suffering. And Philoctetes, at this point, Neoptolemus has gained his trust, and he entrusts Neoptolemus with his bow. And, you know, the chorus says, this is it, you've got the bow, let's go for it, you know? And Neoptolemus actually can no longer participate in the plan of Odysseus. He eventually gives Philoctetes his bow back and promises to take him home, which is what Philoctetes wants. So another question the play poses through the figure of Neoptolemus is the question of how pain is a site for the forging of social bonds, for friendship, for trust, for compassion, for a richness of human relations that comes into relief against the instrumentalization that a figure like Odysseus, whose only goal is to get this guy and get him back to Troy, represents. So the play has this view of Philoctetes, which is very dehumanizing, animalistic, and it also presents this very humanizing view where the relationship between Philoctetes and Neoptolemus is almost a golden age relationship contrasted with contemporary society. The last thing I want to say, and I'm going to be quick because I don't want to cut into Bob's time or our time to talk together, is one of the conundrums, I think, of the play is if Neoptolemus has a nature, Phusis, that can be changed, Philoctetes cannot really be changed. And it's not just a question of how he's been transformed bodily by his suffering, but whether his whole life has been transformed such that can he ever be reintegrated into society? Can he be rehabilitated? The problem of the play is that you need what's called a deus ex machina, a god from the machine, Heracles, to come on stage and tell Philoctetes to go back to Troy. No one can persuade him. Even Neoptolemus, after they've become friends, tries to convince him, you'll gain glory, please come back to Troy, we'll work together. And he says, no way, I want to go home. And so the play asks this question of what, you know, even if Philoctetes is going to go back to Troy, his wound is going to be healed by the sons of Asclepius, but he cannot, he's not going to just forget it. He's become someone through his suffering. And Sophocles is full of characters like this who are heroic if you, from one perspective, rigid from another, but they raise these questions about who we become through the experience of pain. And that question isn't just, I think, answered by Sophocles to say we become hardened or we become animalistic. It's also about how an experience of suffering, and particularly an experience of suffering that is not your fault. That's, I think, really important for Philoctetes, is to push against medicine and law and to say, look, the causality doesn't matter. It's the experience of pain. and who you become. You can't go back to being the person you were before that happened. And that's a question posed by Oedipus too. That would be a whole other presentation, but Oedipus is another very powerful figure with a miasma, a suffering that is not his fault. But by the Oedipus at Colonus, which is a couple years after the Philoctetes, he's transformed by what's happened to him. And he realizes he would not be Oedipus without the suffering that's happened to him. So there's a paradox, I think, in thinking about pain and palliative care. As doctors, as patients, we want to do everything to not end up in a state of suffering. And we want to relieve the suffering once it's there, but we can't erase it. We don't necessarily want to erase what that suffering has produced in terms of the person we've become. And that's a question I think Sophocles is very interested in, and sometimes unflinchingly looks at the harshness of that person, but also the ways in which pain can enrich us, or we learn through that experience. So let me stop there and not take, I'm sorry if I've taken too much time, probably already behind, but I wanted to sort of get those questions on the table.
Great. I think it's my time to respond here. And I'm going to make just a couple of opening comments before maybe one response to what I saw in Philoctetes. But I want you all to know where I'm coming from, since Jack has me speaking three times. And I have this goal also that we, Jack, somehow duplicate the dialogue you and I had on the front porch. So I'm going to try to keep my comments pretty brief. Number one, I don't think I'm unique in palliative medicine. I think palliative medicine is somewhat unique within the larger field of medicine. And that is that we tend to see medicine first and foremost as a moral endeavor, not a scientific endeavor. It's a moral endeavor that uses science and uses the arts in pursuit of the relief of suffering. Many people think, well, the job of medicine is to prolong life, to create immortality. Well, sometimes. But I think those of us in palliative medicine would say that it's a false goal to see medicine as only about prolonging or extending life, let alone creating immortality, let alone creating perpetual youth. Right? So in palliative medicine, we see our calling, our work, as about the diagnosis and treatment and hopefully successful relief of suffering. The other general comment I want you to understand about us palliative medicine professionals is we don't see the suffering as only physical pain. And when I read these texts, there were some things that kind of jumped out at me as a palliative medicine professional. But we talk about something called total pain. We attribute that to Dame Cecily Saunders, the founder of the modern hospice movement, who was first a social worker, then a nurse. She saw a lot of suffering around the end of life. She wanted to change that. This is in Britain in the 50s. And is told by a kindly physician, if you really want to change physicians, you must go and read medicine. So she became a physician, and she became what we would call the founder of the modern hospice movement. Another point, palliative medicine is not hospice. We are involved at an earlier stage, any stage of serious illness. Often, most of the patients we see are still being actively treated for whatever bad disease they have. And Cecily Saunders said, listen, it's not just physical pain, it's total pain. It's physical, emotional, social, and spiritual. And I like to call it physical, emotional, social, and spiritual suffering, because I think, to me, the word suffering captures more than just pain. I think most of us, when we say pain, they just kind of go, I hurt here. And I'm kind of going, no, I want to know about the other suffering that you feel with your serious illness. With that in mind, just as background, because I think it will play into the comments I make on all the readings, one of the things I found most interesting reading about Philoctetes was he describes being lost. He's been on this island for 10 years. He's been in physical pain for 10 years. But I have to imagine that part of his being lost, and we certainly see this in palliative medicine, is he's lost who he was. He's had a complete destruction of his role in Greek society. In the army, he's not welcome anymore. His wound smells bad, and he cries out in pain, and they think he's worthless, not understanding at one point that he's got this magic bow that apparently if he just points it up there, it's going to go over to its target over here and knock everybody down. So I thought that was interesting, because I looked at his suffering as total pain. not just the physical pain of this wound on his foot that causes him to cry out and scream. And it was not clear to me, I actually listened to the whole reading of the entire play, looking for how is Sophocles going to deal and try to remedy mm-hmm. his total pain. And I didn't quite hear that rehabilitative aspect to it as I read the story. But I'm going to stop right there and just open this up for questions from anyone on the panel, anyone in the audience, rather than me rambling on here.
Yeah.
Now, questions.
Yeah. Now your turn to comment and question, and then we'll move on to testament of. Then we'll move on to testament of Job. I'll go with it. It's a lot to throw at you, I know.
Or maybe does Brooke want to respond?
Yeah, Brooke. Any response?
Oh, I think I talked too much. So I would really love it if there were questions.
Well, I actually have a question for both of you. Doesn't someone in the Philoctetes, doesn't someone say it's your fault that you have a snake bite? Isn't there somewhere where they blame him for coming too close to the snake?
What they say is they say that gods have deemed that this is for you to suffer and you have to put up with it, essentially. So there are versions of the myth where he might be being punished for stepping into a shrine or betraying the site of Heracles' burial. But it's a little bit more in the Philoctetes about him, you know, being told by the chorus, who's not particularly sympathetic, you know, look, this is your lot, this is what the gods have determined, and sort of deal with it. So they tend to be more, they're between Philoctetes and Odysseus, the chorus, in terms of how they respond to Philoctetes, but they're largely, they don't exhibit a good deal of empathy.
You know, Brooke, one of the questions I asked you that struck me was he, at one point, Philoctetes asks, basically, that he be killed. He says, cut my foot off even if I die. So I kind of jokingly called it swordsman-assisted suicide, along with the modern notion of physician-assisted suicide or physician-assisted death. And I didn't understand what you explained to me, that one reason Philoctetes has the bow is because he helped someone die?
He helped Heracles die. Heracles has this acute pain. He ends up with this basically flesh-eating cloak that's given to him, and he's in total agony, and no one will help him die. And Philoctetes is the one who lights the pyre that Heracles jumps onto in order to basically accelerate his death and put an end to his suffering. And in recompense, he gives the bow, his magical bow, to Philoctetes. So that's the background in Philoctetes. Possession of the bow.
In both palliative medicine and in hospice, and they're related but not the same, we tend to have pretty high skepticism about physician-assisted suicide. It is now legal in about 5 states, and it's been legalized because the public has clamored somewhat for it, and I think we've all struggled. I get the easy way out as a palliative medicine specialist in Texas. It's illegal here. And when somebody asks me, can you just, and I do get asked several times a year, can't you just speed this up? And I find myself exploring with them, well, we can let go and let God's will be done. We don't have to keep fighting. But if you're asking me to speed this up with a lethal injection, no, I can't. It's illegal. But even more, and that, then I don't have to wrestle so much with the moral piece. But it's interesting that most of us in palliative medicine and hospice are not comfortable with the idea of assisting a patient in taking their life. We're comfortable with saying you can have as much medicine as you need to be asleep. And some patients in hospice may spend the last week of their life just asleep. But they won't get a lethal injection or be given a lethal dose of phenobarbital the way they would get in, let's say, Oregon. The other one observation that we probably need to move on is that in Oregon, where physician-assisted suicide has been legal for about 20 years now, the people who take advantage of it do not take advantage of it because of physical pain. For most of them, it is a loss of their autonomy that drives a loss of their sense of dignity and worth and where they fit in society. And it tends to be predominantly white males, people that look like me but sicker and older, that take advantage of it. So anyway. probably time to move on to the next text.
Yeah, it is. We have a question back here.
We need a mic. You need a mic?
No, I think I can do it.
No, you need a mic so that we can record it.
You're being recorded for posterity. Somebody may watch this someday.
My question has to do with more explanation about what palliative care is. All right, I understand hospice. I assume you're terminal, but you say it's before you get there. You're still being treated, but you're not terminal?
So palliative care focuses on the unit of treatment is the patient and the family. So the cardiologist treats the heart inside the patient, mostly the heart. We treat the patient with the heart disease and their family. So our unit of treatment's a little bit different. We focus on relief of suffering, improving quality of life. Sometimes you relieve suffering by finding something somebody else missed and say, you know, if you'd give this drug, this patient would get better. In palliative medicine, if I'm seeing a cancer patient, one of the best ways to make their cancer pain better is for the oncologist to be able to give them a chemotherapy that helps the tumor shrink. My job gets easier. So in palliative medicine, we say that we see patients with serious illnesses, typically a life-limiting illness, at any age or any stage. In a big hospital like Baylor University Medical Center, where I practice in the hospital, about a third of the patients I see in the hospital will actually die at that hospitalization. They're extremely sick. About a third will go home on hospice. And then another third will go home to continue active treatment of their serious illness for 1 year, 2 years, 10 years, and follow up both with the primary doctor for their serious illness and for the palliative care doctor who specializes in how do we treat your suffering? How do we treat your depression, your anxiety, your dyspnea, your nausea, your physical pain? How do we help your family and you adjust to your new life? I hope that helps a little.
Yeah. Priscilla, do you know how to turn the lights down? Go ahead, you can start.
I'm Angela Kim Harkins. It's wonderful to be with you here tonight. I'm going to speak about the Testament of Job. I'd like to just begin with this image. This is a wood sculpture, the figure of Job, and I chose it because of its three-dimensional aspects. Of course, as a three-dimensional object, the face, I think, is especially expressive when we think about how the light interacts with the contours of his features. And of course, the sort of physicality of suffering, the depths of the sores, I mean, they're all very, very much prominent in this particular depiction of Job. The Testament of Job retells what you know as the biblical book of Job, and provides fuller details about his life. It's thought to have originated as a Jewish work, but as is true of most post-biblical stories, it came to be transmitted by Christians, and its final editing is certainly Christian. The Testament of Job would have been appealing to early Christian communities who, too, shared a desire for moral perfection. We might understand it as an attempt to more fully know who the figure of Job was. But also, we can see it as a means for cultivating the kinds of attitudes and desires that were associated with virtue, such as patient endurance. And those of you who are familiar with the biblical book of Job and its poignant description of suffering, you know that there is quite a strong figure. Job is very angry. You know, this is not the patient Job that we often imagine. But in the Testament of Job, he is actually quite patient and, long-suffering. Okay, so a very different portrait that we find in that text. If we return to this image of Job, what I'd like to do tonight is to really make 5 points about the way the Testament of Job describes Job's suffering and pain. The first one is in the description of suffering itself. In this passage that I chose for you, we read about the chronic pain, the oozing sores that Job is experiencing in his affliction. And this is from the Testament of Job, chapter 20. In great trouble and distress, I left the city, and I sat in a dung heap, worm-ridden in body. Discharges from my body wet the ground with moisture. Many worms were in my body, and if a worm ever sprang off, I would take it up and and return it to its original place, saying, stay in the same place where you were put until you are directed otherwise by your commander. So it's quite a dramatic account of Job. Not only is his flesh ravaged, but the way in which he maintains and actually seems to encourage the worms in the body. It's really quite an extreme description of his chronic pain. The second aspect of Job that I'd like to speak with you about is the sensory aspects of Job's suffering. You know, the Testament of Job is a text, and one of the ways in which the text sort of comes to life in the ancient imagination and certainly in the modern imagination is through the way it really appeals to sensory experiences. And a prominent one is really the sense of smell or odor. So in this picture, and the quote that accompanies it, we see, where is Jobab, the king of all Egypt? They said to them about me, he sits on a dung heap outside the city. For 20 years, he has not returned to the city. So this is a very long and drawn out sort of illness. But a couple things about this quote, Jobab. This is thought to be a kind of reference to the figure of Job. Job was, in the ancient world, actually associated with the patriarchal period in the book of Genesis. And there is a figure named Jobab in Genesis 10 and also in Genesis 36. And the Testament of Job sort of identifies those two figures together. If you remember, Jack said at the very beginning when he spoke about the Testament of Job, he gave you that very colorful image of Job sitting in ashes and scraping his sores with a broken pot. And that is true in the Hebrew Bible version of the book of Job that is familiar to you all. But in the Greek translation of the book of Job, Job does not sit on a heap of ashes, but he sits on a dung heap. And this is actually what the Testament of Job preserves. And it does sort of highlight the way in which the odor that accompanied Job was not just from his wounds, but from his very sort of self-selecting decision to put himself in that kind of filth. And so it's a kind of repulsive image, not just to imagine in your mind with the textures and his open sores. You could also imagine that as well. But the odor is very much a repelling kind of sensory experience. And this picture, I think, well illustrates that, because you can see Job in the foreground, but you see as well the city very much in the background. And we see in through the use of odor this sort of alienation that disease and suffering is sort of places on this particular figure who, as king, enjoyed being in the center of society, but who in his illness then places himself outside of society. And so it's a very, I think this image captures it very well, and it certainly does go back to the Greek text of the book of Job or the Testament of Job. This is another image, medieval image of Job clearly sitting well outside of the city, being visited by his friends. This is an image of a sarcophagus from the 4th century that has a detail of Job. Both of these images are from the same sarcophagus, but in this one, you get a better picture of Job sitting there. But you can see that the figure on the right is holding her nose, and this is Job's wife. We'll come back to Job's wife at the end of the at the end of these slides. Okay, this image is again an illustration of the liminality of suffering that the figure of Job experiences. So in this medieval manuscript illustration, and here I've placed this quote from Testament of Job, chapter 30. Have we not known about the many good things sent out by him into the cities and the surrounding villages to be distributed to the poor, besides those established at his house? How then has he now fallen into such a deathly state? And this particular medieval image of Job actually presents him as a corpse, a kind of living corpse, to sort of express the liminality and the experience of isolation from society, which is what we were talking about in the previous discussion of Philoctetes. In this image, this is the fourth point. The way in which extreme suffering is connected to emotional exhaustion or mental illness. So in this particular image, the figure of Job is robed in green. And you can see the one on the right. I'll start with the image on the far right, sort of withdrawn. You can tell from his face that he's not engaged with his companions, his three friends who come and visit him. And again, the emphasis on the nose and the sort of distancing, just being in his company is a offensive experience that's depicted in the image and also through the language of the text. And the other image that you see on the left, you see that Job is very much directed toward heavenly contemplation. Okay, so he is either withdrawn away from his friends or thinking about otherworldly matters. And in this particular scene from chapter 33, which I didn't preserve, but I'll just retell, Job gives a psalm in which he says the following things. These kings will pass away and rulers come and go, but their splendor and boast shall be as in a mirror. But my kingdom is forever, and its splendor and majesty are in the chariots of the fire. And in this particular moment in the Testament of Job, when Job utters this psalm, his friend Eliphaz is, of course, enraged because, you know, Job's companions in the Testament of Job are all kings themselves. Job keeps company with social peers, and so his friends are all kings as well. And so he wants to immediately leave because this is an insult. These kings will soon pass away. However, he is stopped by Job's friend Baldad, who says, one should not speak that way to a man who is not only in mourning, but also beset by many plagues. Take note, although we are quite healthy, we were not strong enough to approach him because of the foul stench, except by the use of much perfume. You there, Eliphaz, do you forget how you were when you fell ill for 2 days? Now then, let us be patient in order that we may discover his true condition. Perhaps he is emotionally disturbed. So we hear one of the three friends sort of defending Job during his time of misery, that perhaps they could understand his emotional withdrawal or the things that he's saying through the context of his suffering, and that they should perhaps be more patient with him. But this particular scene from the Testament of Job, I think, makes that connection between chronic pain and the emotional exhaustion and perhaps mental illness that might accompany that. And this is a image from the Book of Job, 11th or 12th century commentary from Paris. And what I'd like to draw your attention to is this figure of Job's wife. And notice again, she's holding her nose. This is a sort of key theme in the Testament of Job, but also in the Greek version of the Book of Job. And I draw your attention to it because in many ways in the Testament of Job, the wife is very much a tragic figure. herself. And in this passage, it's a lengthy passage from chapter 25, but I think it speaks to some of the challenges of those who care for people in chronic pain for a very long and extended period of time. It expresses some of that weariness and suffering that they also experienced. And so she says, "Job, Job, how long will you sit on the dung heap outside the city thinking, only a little longer, and awaiting the hope of your salvation? As for me, I am a vagabond and a maidservant going round from place to place. And here you sit in worm-infested rottenness, passing the night in open air. And I, for my part, am a wretch immersed in labor by day and pain by night, just so I might provide a loaf of bread and bring it to you. In the weakness of my heart, my bones are crushed. Rise, take the loaves, be satisfied, and then speak some word against the Lord and die. Then I, too, shall be freed from weariness that issues from the pain of your body." Okay, so it is quite a poignant sort of speech that she gives, and actually, in many ways, you know, Job's wife is really the victim in this story, because she tragically dies not long after she gives this appeal to her husband. But the figure of Job's wife in the Testament of Job, I think, raises the important question of the impact of extreme suffering on caregivers and loved ones, especially when it happens over a long period of time. Okay, and then this is the final image.
Okay, so again, I'm gonna keep it brief in hopes that we get a little bit of dialogue going here, maybe. Reading this as a palliative medicine physician, again, I said, boy, this is total suffering if there ever was any. And the suffering was certainly not only the physical pain of the worms. He had some kind of helminth infection. There are 300 different types of worms that can inhabit our body. And Jack asked, what was that? And I said, I wonder if it was dracunuliasis. And there are these long worms called guinea worm disease that will, and they exist in the Middle East. And I wonder if that's what he had. And they grow inside of us and they break out through our skin. But the more interesting thing
is, so those sores are really good things. They let the worms out.
They let the worms out. And the other part of me reading this is, what kind of mental illness did he have? Mm-hmm. That in his profound despair at the loss of all of his wealth and his children and everything good in life that he had, that he goes and places himself on the dung heap. And the good palliative medicine physician would go to him and explore with him his spiritual pain. That is, in fact, literally what we would do. We might try to slip some medicine in for bipolar disease or something like that also. But really, that's what we would do in palliative medicine. We would actually try to explore the spiritual pain, the emotional pain, the social pain that was driving a behavior that was counterproductive from a modern palliative medicine perspective towards treating total suffering. He's removed himself from every possibility of that. The other comment about Sidis, certainly over my 39 years in clinical medicine now, and I like to think I've been doing palliative medicine before the term had been coined, because I started off, before I opened my office practice, I started off working in a nursing home. And I saw some patients whose life I had saved in the ICU as a medical resident, and I was very proud of that, saving a life's very good, who basically said to me, why did you save my life to send me to this? It was a formative, and my journey into palliative medicine started in that sense in 1981. With that in a nursing home. But over those years, I've certainly seen families that are destroyed by the suffering of their loved ones, absolutely destroyed. They fall apart, they can't come to the hospital, they can't provide the care in the home. And I've seen others who are immensely strong and rally in every perspective in between. So, comments, questions?
Yeah.
Concerns? I can talk forever, but I think that's not the. It's just, when Jack called me, said, you know, so what do you want? He says, well, just a little short reply. Well, that's kind of hard to do. Talking forever is pretty easy.
In the biblical book of Job, even though Job went through emotional, physical, and social suffering, he never gave up his spiritual idea, and that ultimately resulted in his healing. I was wondering if that was consistent with the testament of Job, and also what that says about this idea of the spiritual life and the physical pain being so tightly connected that there's something there that can help us heal, if you will.
Yeah, I think I think you're exactly right to notice that in the Testament of Job, Job's wife is really not a model for us to follow. In fact, you know, it is Job who, during that point in the Testament, actually in his great weakness, actually, we hear about a description of Satan speaking about how Job has really sort of out-muscled him, that he has really struggled to pin Job down. The image is one of wrestling, and that Job has really triumphed. So we very much get the sense that Job is consistent in his patient endurance of suffering. And Job's wife is a tragic figure, and she's really not emulated. That's exactly right.
I would not be so harsh on her as a palliative medicine doctor. I think we try to put ourselves in each person's shoes. I understand that may be a biblical interpretation.
Yes, I mean, I'm speaking about the testament of Job.
Yeah.
But I think it's a very real response to suffering.
One of the other things, I do think the spiritual point is true, and we are spiritual creatures. We are hardwired, we're biologic creatures. Like all living things, we are hardwired to resist death, right? The gazelle runs from the cheetah. All right, we run from the bear in our cave when we were cavemen. We flee from death, but as Homo sapiens, we're capable of thinking about things more than just mere survival. And among the things we're wired to think about is the other. So brain images of nuns praying, Catholic nuns praying to Jesus, and Buddhist monks who are not praying to a deity, meditating, same parts of their brain light up in their meditative activities, very different from what we're doing now. We're using different parts of our brain right now. So we're hardwired to have a spiritual, if not objectively religious, component to our lives, and we keep inventing new religions. Yeah, the Judeo-Christian, Muslim, and Hindu traditions are very old, but, I mean, how many denominations are there in Christianity? Probably as many stars as there are in the universe. I mean, it's just, it seems infinite. They keep getting created, right? Jews were easy. There's about four, I think, for us. It's not nearly as complicated. There is, when we get to spiritual peace at the end of our life, I do think death comes easier. I watched that in my own family with my father. And actually, Job, at the end, 52, Job's death. After 3 days, as Job fell ill on his bed, without suffering or pain, however, since suffering could no longer touch him, on account of the omen of the sash he wore. He had this sash, and we can say, well, did it have a placebo effect? Was it from God? What was it? But the point is after this half a life of suffering, he had a good period in his life, at the very end, he doesn't suffer. And the other interesting thing to me in that, and it'll come up in the Greek life of Adam and Eve, is you had the deathbed scene in a way where people are gathered, and how rare that is in modern medicine because of all the technology that we employ so often at the end of life, which separates the patient from their families who might gather with them. Hard to gather around somebody on ECMO and a ventilator and dialysis in the ICU. So.
Just as a pastor, and as a person who's had some pain of sciatica lately, fairly severe, you know, I've had the choice of sharing that with my parishioners or not, and I've chosen to do that. And I've learned something from it, and that is folks have said, oh, yeah, I've had that too, and it really hurts. And so we've created a community of sorts over empathy from our pain. Rather than suffering with it myself in silence, I've found that that has been redemptive in some ways. Could you all comment on that?
Yeah, I think this idea, well, I'm kind of reminded of what Brooke was talking about, creating social bonds, you know, the way in which, you know, through narrative and suffering, that connection is made. I think that's a very real human experience.
And I agree. And in palliative medicine, again, we don't deal with sciatica. That is, we deal with pain in the setting of a life-limiting illness. So sciatica is important. It really hurts. And pain management doctors and orthopedists and physiatrists and general internists might deal with that. And telling your story has been important because other people have it and you get this shared bonding experience. I would say that in palliative medicine, one of the things that palliative medicine teams do, it's not all about the doctor. It's the doctor, the chaplain, the nurse or nurse practitioner, the social worker. In our hospital, the child life specialist, if we're dealing with, let's say, a young mother or father dying of cancer and they have young children, and how do you deal with that suffering? A big important part of what we do is sitting down and listening to the story, letting the patient tell their story. And when palliative medicine first started, hospitals said, well, we can't afford that. Because you spend 2 hours sitting with the patient and family practicing good narrative medicine, but that narrative medicine is healing.
We will take, at this point, one more question. Okay, this is on. Quick.
All right, thank you. Thinking about the caregiving fatigue, and considering the situation of Job's wife, she has suffered, losing the children, watching the husband wasting away. Is there not a time when the caregivers become sicker than the sick?
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah, we see that. And the other thing I pointed out, we've had some email dialogue back and forth. There's a wonderful lyric from a song I used to sing. Freedom's just another word for nothing left to lose. And Job is truly free. He is truly free. Sidis is not. She's enslaved. And I'm pretty sympathetic to her. And again, as a palliative medicine physician, I'm going, oh my God, she maybe hasn't suffered the physical pains, but she is certainly, she lost her children too. She lost her wealth too. She has been enslaved. He simply said, well, I'm not gonna put up with this anymore. I'm gonna go sit on the dung heap. He's a free soul at that point. So, yeah, it's a different, the perspective of a palliative medicine physician looking at it. Mm-hmm. So, and there's a palliative medicine physician sitting in the audience. Do you disagree with what I'm saying about SIS?
No, I love this last point. I'm just going to make
it very
free.
Wait,
hold on. Dr. Kathy Ligon is a palliative medicine physician with our team in Irving.
Sorry.
Oh, no, I'm sorry. So I like this very last comment. I just wanted to talk about the meaning of suffering and how important that is for framing it as something tolerable. It sounded like him putting the worms back on allowed him to continue his suffering for whatever psychology that is. But his wife, again, this contrast with his wife did not have the meaning for the reason that she was suffering, and I think she was resentful. But he had meaning, and in fact died well because he had meaning.
And we, and what Dr. Logan is saying is absolutely true, and we sometimes ask patients in palliative medicine, if you haven't seen a palliative medicine doctor, you've probably, and God willing, you haven't had to. Because if you're seeing one of us, you have something really serious. Doesn't mean you're hospice, but you've got something really serious. We will sometimes ask people, what does your pain mean to you? Why do you think this is happening? That's generally not something that gets asked in other medical offices. And depending upon the answers we get, we may then utilize that to try to help the patient or the family. What's the meaning of your husband's suffering to you, Sidis? What does this mean? So that's very important. I hope it gives you some little insight into palliative medicine and how it's unique and different. And it, as Jack said, it's very young as a field.
And if I could just say, make one point about Job's wife. You know, in the biblical book of Job, we really don't hear much about her at all, other than, you know, really curse God and die. Although in the Bible, it says bless God and die. But the Testament of Job, I think, really gives us a fuller account of her. She really does grieve for those children who have died. She longs to know that they're there. She's not able to bury them. And she's filled with despair and sadness. So there's a strong way in which we're asked to, you know, on the one hand, really understand her suffering as well. And she does, you know, appear as a very tragic figure. But it's a significant departure from the biblical book.
I consulted with my spouse, who is a tremendously good administrator, and I tend to be a little mushy-gushy on the rules, but we're going to move on to the life of Adam and Eve, because the same questions arise from a different ancient text, and part of what we want to do tonight is to bring together antiquity and the present. So I will keep my I have my thing on. No, I don't. I have it on now. I can't handle two microphones at once, Andrew. Don't expect me to. Okay, so we are going to look, and now this, oh, you got it? At the Greek life of Adam and Eve. Get this handout, please, which is underneath your outline, okay? And this will be your best friend in the next 6 to 8 minutes, okay? Now, the Greek life of Adam and Eve is an unusual embellishment of the story of Adam and Eve and Cain and Abel. For instance, in the Bible, Cain murders Abel, and Abel's blood cries out from the ground. In the Greek life of Adam and Eve, Cain drinks Abel's blood while Abel is pleading for mercy.
It's just the original Dracula.
It really is. It's really awful, isn't it?
Yeah.
So we're going to look very briefly at the Greek life of Adam and Eve and the way at which it changes the biblical text. And we learn an awful lot about pain, disease, and death from the kind of changes that get made. So the first thing on this handout, look at the very first column, Genesis 3, 16 to 19. These are the biblical curses. Now I want you to notice what I underlined and bolded in green. You notice in Genesis 3, to the woman, God says, I'll greatly increase your pangs in childbearing. In pain you shall bring forth children. Two words closely related, itzaphon and eitzev. They're very similar words. And then the same exact Hebrew word occurs in the curse of the man, but it's translated, do you notice, down in the second block on the left, in toil you shall eat of it all the days of your life. The Hebrew, in other words, is ambiguous. Are Adam and Eve cursed with pain, with pangs, or with toil? You think of the idea of labor pains, right? Is this pains the woman is having, or the pain of producing that baby? And what is it? And it's a very ambiguous curse in Genesis 3. Well, when you move on to the Greek life of Adam and Eve, that ambiguity evaporates. So notice Eve's version of her curse in column 3, the top box. Notice in red in the column 3, this is the material that gets added to Genesis 3 in this later version of the Greek life of Adam and Eve. So notice what it says in this third column. You will be in various diseases and in unendurable pains. And then it says, and in 1 hour you will come to give birth, and you will lose your life from your intense bodily anguish and childbirth pains. The ambiguity of the original Hebrew text is gone. What Eve is going to have is pain, pain, and more pain. And I find myself intrigued by this. An ancient story that doesn't move toward a holistic understanding of pain, which we might expect of an ancient story, where spiritual and physical are together, where medical and theology go hand in hand. You know those ancient texts where everything was kind of theological. Nope, not the Greek life of Adam and Eve. The theological dimensions of Genesis 3 evaporate in this text, where all that matters is pain, pain, more pain, and then you die. Now, let's look at Adam's version of his own curse. This is in the bottom half of that chart. And the same exact thing happens. We find the story of Adam's curse here in Adam's version, and notice what happens. In this middle section, chapter 8, in the bottom of the middle column in pink red, God says, since you disregarded my covenant and my command, you disobeyed, I've inflicted upon your body 70 blows. The first disease is a blow, violence to the eyes. The second is a disease of a blow to hearing. And in this way, one after the other, all the blows to your body will follow closely behind. Three elements of Adam's version of his curse seem clear here. Number one, it's the senses rather than the body parts that are cursed. You'll stop seeing, you'll stop hearing, and then the other 68 things will fall apart as well. Second, this is clearly a description of aging. Our eyes go, then our hearing, etc. Or as the Greek life puts it, all the plagues follow close behind. Once you need those glasses, you know what's happening next. I got the first time I got the shot in my back for sciatica, you know, the slipped disc. I go to the guy, Dr. Standard in Seattle. I said, what is it? What caused this? He sits back. He goes, guys in their 40s. Yeah. We know. It's just downhill from there. The third thing we know about this is, and this is interesting, these plagues are not benign. They're not just the inevitable evidence of aging. They're wounds. They're plagues. They're punishments. That's what aging is in the Greek life of Adam and Eve. Now, Eve tells the story as well, and she has her own version of the curse. This is in the bottom right-hand box, and she says in red, and you will be in various diseases, oppressed by bitterness, you will not taste sweetness, having been oppressed by burning heat and constrained by cold. This is probably the ancient theory of the humors, that your body responds to its environment, heat and cold. It's why sometimes we put someone who's very, very hot, don't we, in ice. Do we ever do that? Because, not because we believe in the ancient theory of humors, but there's this interconnectedness between environment and body. When your body's too hot, you have to balance it with something that's cold. If there's something bitter in your body, you have to eat something sweet. For Adam, cold, heat, bitterness, that's it. My question is this: what do we make of an ancient tale that is obsessed, positively preoccupied, not with the spiritual dimensions of pain, but with the physical dimensions of pain. The curse is not feeling bad. The curse is not separation from God. The curse is pain, pain, and more pain. Now, having said that, there are four effects of pain that are not physical in the Greek life of Adam and Eve. I'll run through these and give Bob the floor. Though he's surrounded by his family, and I've listed these on that little outline, the four effects. Though he's surrounded by his family, and all his children are there, and Eve, his wife, is there, Adam's pain and disease isolate him. His wife and his children are clueless about his condition. Standing at Adam's deathbed, his son Seth asks, "How did this happen?" His children ask, "What is pain?" Isolated by pain. Point number two, Adam's pain evokes intense sympathy from those around him. Seth, his son, offers to put dung on his head and repent. It's pretty empathetic. And then Eve begs Adam to take half his pain. "Please take half, let me take half your pain, Adam, because it's on account of me that you're feeling this." Joe Calandrino, one of our team members from Long Island, said, "It's interesting, she only offers to take half his pain." But there is a level of empathy there, even if it's calculated.
People are too hard on spouses, in my view.
Okay, good, yeah.
We'll come back to this.
Yeah, we'll come back.
I read Joe's comment. I thought, what is he talking about?
Okay, the third point is Adam's pain calls for desperate measures. So what he does is, as a last-ditch effort, what Adam does is he says, "Okay, Seth, Eve, go back to paradise. Go get the oil of mercy to alleviate my pain." It's a last-ditch effort. It doesn't work. The archangel says, "Nope, no alleviation of pain until the resurrection. That's it. Go back." The fourth thing we learn about pain, the fourth effect, is it brings the revelation of long-held secrets. The cat is now out of the bag. Adam knew about his curses, the 70 blows, the bitterness, the heat, and the cold, a millennium earlier. The guy's 930 years old. He knew about it in paradise before God kicked him out. But he and Eve clearly kept it to himself. The effect of pain, 900 years later, at his deathbed, he finally tells his children the dirty little secret of disobedience.
So I didn't read the text. I didn't read the pain quite the way my scholar of ancient texts read it, and he gets all the credit here, not me. But I preferred to call this the, it was not pain like Philoctetes' pain. That's very clear, to me at least, reading the Greek life of Adam and Eve. So not the same kinds of pain. And I read it through a geriatrician's eyes and just said, this is aging. And it's interesting to me that the kids are kind of saying, "Well, what disease do you have?" And Adam never answers. He didn't say, "I have a disease." He's just old. And it's what's happened, and we ache and we hurt as we get older and things begin to fall apart. And when I was a 30-year-old geriatrician, I understood that in a textbook sense. As a 64-year-old man, I would love to live to be 84, and I did one of those doing some retirement planning. I went to Northwestern Mutual Life, and you can plug in all your health numbers, and it will say somebody like you is likely to live to be X, and it said 93, and I said, "I'm going to work a little longer." I want to get old, but you know, we feel, and as I look at gray hairs in the room, you feel things that start to go wrong as you get older. So I looked at this more about aging, and that these youngsters just couldn't understand that, because he wasn't calling it aging. I'm, again, much more sympathetic to the spouses in these stories than maybe I should be, but that was my other observation. I thought that she said, "I will take on some of your pain." She showed true empathy, unlike Neoptolemus in Philoctetes, who's sympathetic but not empathetic. And that's an important difference in palliative medicine. Almost everybody can be sympathetic. You say, I'm sorry for your pain. Now I will go call a specialist to deal with it. Goodbye. The empathetic person sits down and says, tell me about your pain. Help me understand your pain, even though I cannot possibly walk in your shoes. But if I spend some time listening, and I will aspire to find a way to make it better. And in that sense, empathy has an aspirational quality or component to it that at least I perceive Sidis in that way. That I think her comment, whether it's curse God or praise God so that you can then die, I think that was out of empathy for his suffering and not just, I'm sorry about your suffering, I'm going back into the town now. Mm-hmm. So I'll cut my comments off and see what kind of questions we get. Mike.
I'm not familiar with this, the Greek version or the the Eves or Adams is a separate. In the Bible, how much of what we read today has been reinterpreted by people who want to believe that Jesus is the Jesus of pain, of everything's fine. I'm not. But what has impacted to get us from the Greek life to what we read in our typical Bible?
The palliative medicine specialist is not going to try to answer that one. Not when I'm sitting with two.
Well, and Brooke as well, because, she was saying, it's called pathemathos, right? Learning through suffering. So the tragedies deal with these very questions as well. I can't speak to what has led to this sort of American cultural emphasis on bright white teeth as opposed to enduring suffering, because I'm not an Americanist. Andrew Klump, my graduate assistant, may want to speak to it. He doesn't want to speak to it. I will say what these ancient texts give us. They give us a reality without palliation. In fact, I don't know, Bob, if this is true, but Joe Calandrino was saying, because I was talking about the Testament of Job with Joe Calandrino, and I loved Angela's image. They're all holding their noses. I mean, they can't stand the stench of Job. No wonder he goes to a dung heap. At least he has an excuse for smelling bad. But he smells so bad. And, Joe actually said, yeah, well, the word pallium was actually a cover, sort of a possible perfume of some sort. So I think we've gotten better at covering pain and suffering. But in antiquity, I don't think they had the ability to cover it in the same way. Brooke, do you want to respond to this?
Well, I would just point out, I think to stress in the Philoctetes myth, it's the sound. The sound of Philoctetes is akin to the smell, I think, in the Job story. There's a lot of emphasis on the unbearable quality of his cries that exclude him from the human community. And his own oscillation in the play between, on the one hand, these cries, you hear these cries, and on the other hand, you hear him speaking, and not just speaking, but speaking Greek, which is seen by Philoctetes and those in the play as like the ultimate form of sort of human expression and humanizing. So there's a lot of play, I think, in the tragedy between this very unvarnished view of suffering and this animalizing view, and it's juxtaposed with this sense of a human being in a very rich sense. The other thing I was going to say was, I think, Greek material is a bit funny because you do have starting in the 5th century into, with the rise of medicine, naturalizing medicine, not just an account, kind of biological explanation of disease, but with the belief that one can control disease through mastery of knowledge of the body, rather than propitiating the gods or anything like that, but that the techne, could master disease, you really get the sense that health is an ethical concern. And I find a lot of resonance between American obsessions with health and the idea that you could always have done something differently so that you didn't end up in this position. There's always a kind of implicit sense, I think, of blame, that a culture that prioritizes health and prioritizes self-care the way that American culture does, there's always a kind of residual problem of blame and shame attached to disease. And I think the Greek material, in part because of the very powerful cultural role that biomedicine develops, has something similar. And so sometimes it's argued that the rise of a Christian ethic in later antiquity is in some sense a response to the Greek fetishization of health, which goes hand in hand with a very powerful role that medicine and a belief in medicine as an all-powerful technique occupies in the culture. So tragedy is, and that's one thing I wanted to stress, tragedy is not the one expression of Greek culture. It's a discourse that's in tension with and in dialogue with a discourse of mastery of stuff, of pain, and very resonant, I think, for our own culture and the ways in which medicine often is seen as a kind of form of mastery of pain.
Okay, we have, Jack, I have two questions.
This may touch somewhat what you mentioned there, but what I'm wondering is a relationship between pain and transformation.
Is that for all of us, sir?
You can take it first, says the power of medicine doctor.
That's a general question, I should say.
All right. Go ahead, Bob. Yeah.
Again, in the realm of palliative medicine, we do explore meaning. We do find sometimes that if we can get to the underlying meaning of pain and help the patient reach acceptance. You all are familiar with the Kubler-Ross concept that we're given bad news. You have denial, anger, bargaining, depression, acceptance. And these come and go in the course of a long, serious illness. But I do think there are patients who sometimes overcome their pain in ways that I cannot attribute entirely to the methadone I'm giving them. Again, I've got a fellow palliative medicine physician in the audience, and I'm seeing you nod sometimes that will see that. And you realize, all right, this patient is getting to a point of a true acceptance of where they are in their life's journey. The other thing we see is patients who are often doing what we call chemically coping. They're seeming to need more pain medicine than we think the physical findings might necessarily justify. And they're taking the medicine, they're wanting it much more often than pharmacokinetics say it should be needed. And I'm very generous with pain medicine, more than most palliative medicine doctors. I'm gonna probably shock Kathy, I bet, when she starts working with me. But still, there are patients who are chemically coping, and when you delve into that, it's often spiritual pain or social pain that is not being dealt with, and they prefer, rather than deal with that spiritual or social or emotional pain, they just want to be knocked out all the time. And to my way of thinking, there's nothing wrong with being knocked out all the time at the very end of your life, especially if you have bad physical pain. Sometimes that's the only thing we can do to relieve your physical pain. We call that palliative sedation at the end of life. But that's maybe 5% of the patients we see at the end of life, 3% of the patients we see at the end of life. So I do think pain changes us, sometimes much for the worse, as in we talked about chronic pain and how Philoctetes is really destroyed by 10 years of chronic isolation and chronic physical pain. But sometimes Job, after all of his suffering, the last 3 days of his life, he's at peace. And Adam, I think, is at peace.
He's asleep. He's not at peace.
Well,
he's just asleep.
Yeah, he and I, we had a good debate on the
sleep on his deathbed. We have one. Yeah, he's only happy because he's asleep. Okay, we got one more. We have another question. This will be the last question. We can hang around here, even Brooke, maybe. Brooke, can you hang for a few minutes?
A few minutes, yeah.
Yeah, she has to go home. Yo, it is much much later there. Yeah. That's right. It's 10 o'clock there. But it's New York. The city never sleeps.
So the question
sleeps, I'm sure.
The question I had, I've been a pulmonologist for 25 years and a hospice physician for 15. And we're going to meet at the end of this. You and I. No,
me?
No, you and I.
No, Jack.
I'm Joe.
Okay. Oh, you're me.
Our email. Yes.
What are you pointing at?
Sorry. The question or the comment that I wanted to make and have you discuss is one of the themes that runs through all of this, I think, is isolation. Mm-hmm. And I think the great metaphor for this was the holding of the noses, you know, in the Testament of Job. As somebody who deals with people at the end of life very regularly, the most difficult cases for me are the social cases. The vast, vast majority of people, we can take care of their physical suffering. I think the most difficult suffering that we tend to deal with are the isolation. And the question I want to talk about is the change in relationships that occur with terminal diagnoses, family reactions, because it seems to me that less of it, in some cases, has to do with the patient's reaction, and more of the suffering has to do with the reaction of the patients around them and the change in those relationships and how they deal with those changes. Some people are very empathetic and embrace the patient, and other people find ways to depart or deny, or there are all different kinds of reactions. And of course, in hospice, we always consider the patient and the family as that, you know, unit that we're giving care to.
I agree. I mean, we belong to the same tribe. So, yeah.
In the Greek life of Adam and Eve, I'm so struck by, and really, it's really in beginning to talk to the palliative care people, I'm so struck by the dynamic of the relationships. So, you know, gathering children around your bed is a very ancient Jewish testamentary thing. If anybody who died who was important, they gathered their family around, and they said, hey, you know, like Judah, one of the testaments of the 12 patriarchs, Judah says, I had sex out of marriage. Don't you ever have sex out of marriage. Then he dies. And so these 12 patriarchs of Israel, they each tell their sin and say, don't you do that same sin, then they die. So there's nothing all that holy in these ancient texts about gathering your family, but watching the questions, what's going on? They're so puzzled, they're so worried, they don't know what's going on. And that's what strikes me as the alienation in relationships that happens once Adam is dying. But I was struck by all the different exiles. So Philoctetes is physical exile. Job is self-exile. Adam is exile from family, even though they're surrounding him. And what struck me the most in reading all of these, and we've been shooting emails back and forth all week, is the various kinds of exile that happen with pain. And I've just been stunned by that in antiquity.